My name is Moses Powell. I've been studying jiu-jitsu for the last 20 years. I'm the master for Render Visitation. And at this particular time, I'm a senior master in the art of jiu-jitsu te and jiu-jitsu ryu.
.radio.net presents to you some of the most deadly jiu-jitsu masters in the world. Trained in the vicious urban inner-city street combat system of Sanukis Ryu Jiu-Jitsu, this art was created by the legendary Dr. Moses Powell, the father of American contemporary jiu-jitsu and the greatest martial artist of the 20th century. This network brings together four radio shows four nights a week, starting with Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. Each one teach one, with the Pia Master himself, Grandmaster Urban Muhammad, and his protege, Professor Terence Hale. Wednesday nights at 9 p.m., Modern Combat Masters, hosted by the inheritor of GM Billy Davis Jiu-Jitsu, guru of his own Filipino system, and Sanukis Master, Grandmaster Daryl Sargent, and his co-host, Sifu Rosita De Jesus. Thursday nights at 9 p.m. is Professor Tom Curry's radio talk show. A Kenpo master and professor of Sanukis Ryu, 20 years law enforcement, senior tactical training instructor for intelligence retired, and author of the official Sanukis Ryu Jiu-Jitsu testing and training curriculum. And Friday nights at 8 p.m. is Making the Connection, hosted by the president of DocRadio.net, grandmaster in the art of Sanukis Ryu and Soke of Kuroshi Kaikan Martial Arts System, and president of the Family of Sanukis Organization, Soki Haisan Kalik, and his co-host, Shihan Farouk Gibbs. All of these shows can be linked to online by typing in docradio.net or listening live at the scheduled time by dialing 646-716-6825. DocRadio.net is also proud to present DocMagazine.net, the world's largest martial art magazine dedicated to Dr. Moses Powell, Sanukis Ryu Eye-to-Eye Jiu-Jitsu, Urban Tactical Street Self-Defense, and Streetology. Please join our Facebook group by typing in docradio.net and follow us on Twitter by typing docradio.net. Thank you for your support, and in the words of Doc, eye-to-eye, heart-to-heart, to the wall and back, us.
Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to All the Mat. This is the Full Concert Radio. And we have a great dogs institute with Ali Abdullah. He's a master, and he's a jiu-jitsu master, and he's definitely a very top elite level as a martial artist in general, specifically in the ninjutsu, family. Without any further ado, let me see if Hanchi is just joining. Hanchi?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir. How you feeling?
Okay, and yourself?
Good. Let me just give you the formal greeting. Yes, sir.
Most appreciated.
Before I get into the interview, let me just first by thanking you for giving the opportunity to interview you, and it's it means a lot to me. I mean, you're definitely a legend amongst the martial arts community. I mean, you're definitely at the top. I mean, you are an elite martial artist, and so it's definitely an honor that you've taken time out of your busy schedule, which I'm sure you're very busy, to give me this honor to interview yourself.
Well, I appreciate you having me here, and I'm honored and humbled based on your remarks. And, by Allah, I just hopefully I can live up to, positive expectations, inshallah.
Yes, yes. On the Full Concert Box show, I try to each show, I try to have a guest appearance co-host. So I don't always announce them. So tonight, the guest co-host will be Senior Professor Saifullah Amariki. Have you ever heard of this gentleman?
Have I ever heard of him? I've more than heard of him, and this is my what we can consider each other my close companion, not
yes,
just
sir.
A friend. Not a brother in Islam, but my close companion, man, my compadre, you know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. He's definitely an elder to me. He's a high ranking person in the Sanukin family that you know we all look to as well to draw the knowledge from. And he'll also be blessing me with an honor to be my co-host, and he'll be joining us in the first hour of the show, the first half of the show. I have some questions, but I'm going to let him, you know, get into the meat of it, and then he has to depart at a certain part, and then you and I are going to go to YouTube and break down some of your clips, and we're going to allow you to break down your techniques and interpretations of what you're doing for the audience.
Right.
So without further ado, let me go ahead and bring in Professor Saifullah. Professor?
Yes, assalamualaikum. All right, what's up? You hear me?
Waalaikum salam. Yes.
Ali.
Yes, sir, my brother.
Grandmaster.
Inshallah.
My man, pots and pans.
Hey, you got that right, man. Right
you,
back at
hey,
you, my brother.
Hey, look, you do whatever you can. That's we have a hot town and a good. Let's say a hot time in the old town tonight.
Hot time in the old town tonight. Hey, that's nice. I like that.
Hey, before we bless the audience with this historical, let me just tell you people something. First of all, 646-716-6825. It's a Full Concert Shabbat show. I got on the line a living legend. Actually, got two living legends. I got Hanchi Ali Abdul Karim, and I also have Senior Professor Saifullah Amariki. I mean, to have these two men, you know, in my presence, and I'm just you know I'm just rapping with them. I mean, it's an honor, but. So before I do it, I actually want to set the spirit right. I want to put it in the right spirit of this show. So I'm going to just play a little something that you might have heard of. I'm not sure if you heard of it. And then after it goes off, I'm going to get right into the show. Give me 1 minute.
You can't take a man and tell him he must be rigid when he flows, you know, like a stream.
I had never seen jujitsu done, and to see this huge person just flying through the air and rolling out, not making a sound, is very beautiful, very frightening.
He's big, and he's fast, and he's knowledgeable, and he's a gentleman, and he's an exceptional man.
My type of rollouts are not like you might take it, like it just looks beautiful, but it's a very dangerous thing because if I can attack with those, then it's something else, you know. And most people just look at it and say, it's unbelievable, but they don't even see the point because whoever blocked the rollout.
So let me jump right into it. How did you come up with this name, Star and Crescent School of Essential Knowledge Ninjutsu?
Well, you know, back in the early and middle 70s, I decided to, construct the school. And what was happening is that, I trained, my primary teacher is Professor Ronald Duncan. And he was on Court Street, and I lived in Red Hook Projects. He was in, you know, I was in South Brooklyn in Red Hook Projects. Court Street, where he was right on the outskirts of the projects. And when I started training with him, and I had, other peers that I were related to in the projects. And what happened was is that, a lot of the people I associated with and befriending the projects were not able to afford going to martial art classes, you know, the charges that, and the fees that he was charging, although compared to what they charge now, was just extremely minimal. But they couldn't afford it, you know. So what I did was I used to go to the community center. It used to be the PAL Center, P-A-L. And I spoke to the director there. I was very close to the director. It was a African-American gentleman, you know, called Ethna Green. He, you know, he was a neighborhood brother. He grew up in the neighborhood, and he became the director of the center. So I had reached out and appealed to him about starting a martial art class with the neighborhood, you know, neighborhood kids and children in the area. So he allowed me to do so, and I opened the school. So I was trying to come up with a name, you know, that would really fit what I was trying to do, you know, in terms of my expression, because in the martial arts, you train in the martial arts and you reach a certain level, but everybody takes away certain aspects of what they're training in, you know, whatever fits a person's character, whatever fits his particular spirit and his mentality, he takes away from that, and everybody basically develops a certain character of their own in the martial art. So what I did was I decided to use, you know, the Star and Crescent, you know, School of Essential Knowledge. And the Star and Crescent, although it's not an Islamic symbol, but it is associated with Muslims in that sense, I just wanted to take on the guise of something that was associated, something that we deal with. You know, we consider, you know, the crescent is like the start of the start of a month. It's the start of Ramadan and start of each month and start of Hajj and Eid and so forth. So I took it under that guise, you know, and the Star and Crescent is basically, you know, like a sign from Allah in that sense. And it's, like I said, it's associated with Muslims, although it's not an Islamic sign, but it's a sign that some people associate with Muslims. Some countries like Turkey and so forth have taken on that particular symbol. So I took on that symbol based on that concept. And when I took on the name Star and Crescent School of Essential Knowledge, I took it on as essential knowledge, meaning that in its ninjutsu, when you look at and you study historically, ninjutsu borrows from everybody. When it first started out, the ninja were people that were in the village of, you know, certain villages in Japan, but they were being oppressed. And out of desperation, when you talk about survival, what they did was they developed a system of survival for themselves. You see, because the samurais were the only ones that were traditionally and formally trained in martial art training. You know, so the ninjas, what they did was some of them went up into the mountains in the area where you had yamabushis, you know, what they call yamabushis, you know, warrior monks. And also they came across Chinese, you know, monks and Chinese people who are, you know, or Chinese masters that were up in the mountains. And what they did was they trained, and they were taught by these monks, and they were taught by some levels of Chinese practitioners in that area. And what they did was they came down, and most of the time when the Japanese get a hold of anything, they basically shape in a fashion around their culture and their character. So they took took this art and they started teaching it among their people, and they perfected on it based on their environment. They perfected it on there. So what I find in studying the martial arts, and also what I got from Professor Duncan, is that, you know, he took the essence of different fighting systems, and he made it adapt to his particular way of fighting. So I took on that particular, you know, character, and I extracted that particular principle from what I've been taught and from what I studied. So that's why I call it the School of Essential Knowledge, because we want to deal with the essential part of fighting, get rid of all the rest. Not that we don't employ, you know, basic and formal training, but we take the essence of that training and we incorporate it in our particular method of approach in terms of fighting, and then we utilize it. So we utilize the essence. The essence is basically the part of the training and part of the principles that you will apply when it comes to real combat. So that's why I took on, so I call it the School of Essential Knowledge, the Koguru. Koguru system is basically the system that, I've been trained under from Professor Duncan. And, you know, and we took those essence, and then we took on, it was the way to win, but then I added the way to winds and water. Because, and I was just talking to one of my schoolmates and classmates, and we were talking, he says that I've been taking on the elements of the martial arts. And martial art, in respect to the Chinese and the ninjutsu systems, deals with the elements. It deals with the character of the wind, the character of water, the character of iron, the character of fire, and the character of wood. You know, we all have these particular elements within us. Man is the only creation that can imitate and mimic all the other creations. We can mimic animals, monkeys, tigers, you know, snakes, all kind of different elements. We can imitate the wind. We can imitate the water. We take on the characters and we make it adapt to human nature. And so this is how I came up with all these principles, and I still employ this understanding, and I instill this understanding within my circle in terms of my students and so forth. So that's how I took on that's how I adapted to the name Star Crescent School, School of Essential Knowledge, the Way of the Wind and Water, Koguru.
Just to kind of update you on this format. With this format, I'm going to run you through about 10 questions, and I'm going to pass over to the senior professor, let him run you through whatever he, you know, let him exhaust his questions, and then until he has to leave. But between our prior to me passing it off to him, I'm going to have a 1 minute commercial break. I'm going to 1.5 minute break, and we'll let you kind of relax to get back into the next set of questions that's going to come. I'm senior professor, so I'm just kind of like updating both of you actually in terms of the format of the show, so we can have a good flow. So the next question is, what is the relationship between Master Khalifa in Brooklyn and your dojo?
Master Khalifa, is one of my schools that I in Master Khalifa, I have one of the schools that's presenting the system. I had a few students there. They're my assistant in training. Other students that come to Master Khalifa. My particular school is the major school, and I have a branch of schools, you know, throughout the city. I have one in Staten Island, Bensonhurst, and my son teaches out in Virginia. I have schools that are connected to me in terms of students. I have Sensei Askia who teaches out in Georgia, and then I have one of my other students, Mustafa Abdullah, who teaches out in East Orange. So we have these schools now, but Master Khalifa is one of the schools that I have they train on Tuesdays and Thursdays, the 7 to 10.
Now, Hanshi. Now, the next question is: now, out of all the martial arts that you've come across, what was it about ninjutsu that captivated you?
Well, let me just say this much. When I first started, I started training in the martial arts in 1968, and it was dealing with the neighborhood friends of mine who were training in Shotokan karate, and they 68. You're talking about martial art was something really mysterious. It was still had that mystique to it, you know, unknown. What we saw was some martial art, maybe some martial art play, and on TV every so often somebody would do what we call a judo chop. You know, we went crazy. But my friend, these two friends of mine, one was named Paul. They were studying with a gentleman. His name escapes me at the moment, and they were doing a lot of katas, you know, the heian katas, you know, and so forth. So what I did was, you know, I appealed to them to start training me. So they started training me. And I was doing katas and so forth. I didn't really get into the technique aspect of it, but I was doing a lot of katas, especially the heian katas. And as we build up, you know, the different katas that employed certain forms and fighting and striking and so forth. And then from there, then my brother had influenced me also. He was in the Air Force, and he had studied Aikido and Judo, and he started teaching me some aspects of Aikido, from there, I decided at one point, I said, well, look, man, and he said, well, I need to go to a formal school. So I wanted, so that's what we did. We had embarked on going to a school. Now, a good friend of his, Ron Van Cleef, him and Ron Van Cleef was a transit police officer. My brother was also a police officer in projects. And Ron Van Cleef were good friends. So he knew that he had a school, and we decided that we would go to that school, and then I would sign up and so forth and train with him. So happened that the school was closed, but I had already knew about Duncan, on Court Street. So I decided, well, look, man, since he's closed, I want take me to Duncan. I had no idea of ninjutsu at the time. And, so from that time, the school was closed. We went to Duncan, and I signed up. Now, one thing when I was in Duncan, that's in 69. When I was with Duncan, in the beginning, ninjutsu was not the play. We were doing kempo karate, we're doing jujitsu, aikijitsu, and weaponry and other different aspects of fighting. The school was called American Bushido. That was the name. That was the name of Duncan School in the beginning. So we didn't really get into the ninjutsu until later on, And then, as he gradually brought us into the martial art fighting systems, then he introduced the old form of kempo, not the American kempo, but the old form of Kihon kempo or Kokoro kempo, which is the old Japanese striking forms, during the time of Japan in the 1400s, they had, where jujitsu came out of, even jujitsu came out of the samurai forms of movements and locks and things with their swords. And then developing of kempo, kempo had a form in which the Japanese would strike in a sword-like pattern with their hands and with their arms. The fist came into when they talked about, because the kempo was used, or the term kempo was used even in feudal Japan, but it was dealing with the way of the fist, the way of the intelligent fist. The term comes from the Chinese form called chung fa. Chung fa is a form of fighting in the fist. So because the Japanese didn't have the striking methods that they had, like we have today in karate, it came from Okinawa. And the Okinawans were close to the Chinese. A lot of the Goju-Ryu has Chinese forms, and Okinawan Te had Chinese moves. And if you notice, like crane moves and things of that nature. So he introduced these things to us, because Duncan was very, very versatile. I mean, he had knowledge of many, a vast number of fighting forms. Then afterwards, ninjutsu was introduced to us, and that was fascinating to me because of the method of ninjutsu. What made me attracted to it even more and stick with it to this very day is its unorthodoxy and its method and its fighting forms and the different adaptations in terms of fighting. Now, this takes nothing away from all the other systems, because what happens with ninjutsu, being that ninjutsu is a conglomeration of all different kind of fighting systems, if you notice, the ninjutsu forms, or the shinobi no jutsu, which is the real term that is used, ninjutsu is basically a contemporary term, but shinobi no jutsu was used first. It's called the shadow warrior techniques, or the art of the shadow warrior. You notice that the Japanese didn't have this crouching, rolling out in the fashion, and fighting in a low position, high position, and jumping position. That came from the Chinese, because the Japanese didn't have most of the Japanese form was upright. There would be no crouching, like if you were crouching down to the ground and so forth. So these things I was attracted to, and it made me also appreciate all the other systems, because I take nothing away from any other systems. I love them all, and it made me appreciate all the other systems. I practice in a lot of systems, from Japanese to Chinese systems. I practiced in a lot of these systems. I exchanged with other practitioners, you know, from all different walks of fighting, you know. So, but because of the type of method that ninjutsu uses to basically accomplish and achieve its objective, and that objective is, like all objectives, the concepts that come from all the martial art, is to win. That's why one of its concepts is the art of winning, you know, to win by whatever means is necessary. It's a survival art, and that's, you know, and it still fascinates me to this very day.
Oh, Hanshi, my next question. Can you tell us something about your martial arts, for instance, about your parents and how life was like growing up?
You say that again? Repeat that.
Can you tell us something about your life before martial arts? Like, for instance, about your parents, or how was life growing up?
Oh, yeah. Well, my life before martial arts was, again, I grew up in Red Hook Projects in the 50s. My parents, you know, were very strong, religious, strict, moral, you know, parents that, you know, that really took care of their children. My father was a hardworking individual. My mother was hardworking. She took care of the household. She brought us up. My father was in the house. My father took care of business. My mother took care of business. And in my neighborhood, you know, it was Red Hook. Red Hook was, to me, a very unique environment and a very unique place. Because we, you know, Red Hook was, you know, in terms of most of the projects, everybody knew each other. Everybody knew each other's parents. Everybody knew each other's family. Sometimes we ate over the house with each other. Sometimes we, you know, slept overnight. I mean, it was just that kind of thing. It was really a family affair. You know, to this very day, we go to the old-timers' day, and everybody still greets each other like we've known each other, and we've known each other for years, like we've never left each other. I had a very, I had a very interesting and very adventurous life. You know, most of my life was built around it. You know, around, you know, just dealing with situations. We were very active socially. We were very active, you know, in terms of sports, domestically. You know, or we had fun doing whatever we were doing. You know, we struggled at certain times. We dealt with situations. The friendship was real close. When you had, you know, and like in the projects, they had little different groups. And, you know, I had my little group. Well, we were the youngest of all the groups that existed there. You know, I seen back in the early 50s, 60s, you know, I seen gang fights. You know, they had different gangs. And I used to see my brothers and all out there and, you know, things of that nature. But overall, man, in terms of my parents, you know, they were not Muslim, but under the circumstances, if I had to be born in a non-Muslim household, that was the best household I could ever born in, because they had the morals. They were very religious. I never seen my parents didn't drink and smoke. I never heard my father utter a curse word. I never seen my parents really fight, you know, like real fight. They even argue, but nothing, you know, no abusiveness and so forth. So I had a very, very, I would say, sound childhood, you know, based on that.
Hanshi, how did your life change? How did your perspective of life change the day you got your black belt, the day you was on your first Shodan in ninjutsu? How did that, what year was it, what was going on, and how did that alter your perspective of life in the martial art?
Yeah, and that's an interesting take. I moved up, you know, to green belt, you know, because I was, like I said, since 69, I'm turning over 41 years, you know, in the system. And, you know, I trained, I moved up, I skipped yellow belt, went from white to green. And, you know, then I started training. At one point I had to leave, but I came back. And my, you know, since I couldn't afford it at the time, but Duncan said, look, you just come back, you know, clean the dojo, whatever the case is, and, you know, and we'll take care of the rest. And so I trained. And then when I came back, I was studying. I was still, because I had the center, and I was still training and, and keeping myself in shape and teaching, and then I came back, and then he put me under a test, and I went from green belt to brown belt. Now, the interesting thing about how I got my Shodan, and it had to be somewhere around 73, because I became Muslim, and that changed my whole life. I became Muslim right on my birthday, May 17, 1973, and that changed my whole lifestyle. I was always looking for, you know, some principle, because I was into the Eastern, you know, religions, and I wasn't into it like deep, but I had just extract certain principles that I had adapted to, that I had employed in my lifestyle, you know. Quite naturally, I had my struggles. You know, I was out there, you know, I mean, drugs was all around, although I didn't shoot no drugs and this and that. But, you know, we were into a lot of the party stuff and things of that nature, so I struggled with that. But I'm so good. Oh, thank Allah that it was short-lived. I got into things late and got out early, only by Allah, the permission of Allah, and it's a blessing. So what happened was there was one time we came to the dojo. Now, every so often, old Sensei Duncan would take us through some rigid training. And then sometimes we would have to get into some rigid fighting. You know, he would just, you know, just pick a day. You never know when that day was going to be. He'd just throw that on you, and just we just go at it. He'd get you up there. You got to do techniques, people attacking you, all kind of stuff. So there was one time that I came to the dojo. I was a brown belt then, you know. And I went from, like I said, from green to brown belt. I didn't have a purple belt. Went from green, white to green, and green to brown. So one day, you know, it was one of those days. He just put us through it, and we was throwing down. I was a short guy. I was about maybe 5'5" or whatever, 145 pounds. And we had some big bruises there. You put two big bruises, Caucasian brothers that was on there that I know, two twins that I grew up. They grew up in the projects with me, you know. And they were vicious. I mean, we had some real vicious twos, you know, and students, man, in that dojo. And, you know, and I was, by law, I was taking care of what I had to do. But there was one individual. His name was Russell. Baddest dude. I mean, in terms of fighting and technique, but his sparring was superb. Now, when he fought one individual, right? He was a black belt, and I was still a brown. And Russell was a black. He might have been like second degree or whatever case is. And the first guy he fought, you know, he had a vicious spinning back kick. I mean, and he would catch everybody with that. But, you know, being in the dojo, I'm watching. I'm observing everybody for you, you know, just observing fighting systems fight. I never was pitted against him because I wasn't up to that rank. But, and this is the first time I was pitted against him in this instant. So he did his spinning. It was a spinning spinning back kick, and he caught this one of the students, and the student went into convulsions, you know, he knocked him, you know, and like caught him good. So after they took care of the student and revived him and everything was okay, Duncan put me against him. Now, I've been watching him. I watch his moves. I watch his timing, and I got him. And we were going at it, right? But there was something about when I knew he was setting up for that spinning back kick, and I watched him, and then he made the move. I timed it. I went down, and before he can complete the move, I came up and I caught him while he was in motion, in midstream. I caught him. I brought him down. I did what I had to do, and that was it. I got my black belt that day. You know?
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah, alhamdulillah. I said, wow. The training was, or the that particular segment had nothing to do with us being tested, but because old Sensei, you know, by Allah's permission, was impressed, he said, now you can wear your black belt. like that, you know. So I said, oh, mashallah. So that changed the whole thing from that day on, man. I mean, you know how it is when you, you know, when, especially when it's done in that fashion, when you don't even know, you have no idea. You just put your spirit in what you have to do. But what it is it just shows that, you know, when you know you're going to be tested, you prepare for a test. With Duncan is that every day is a test. I'm observing. That's the way I teach my. That's the way I deal and observe my students. You know, I tell them. I said, you know, I know this is what Sanukis and all the other schools do. You know, you what you're telling your student, you say, look, you know, your test starts in your class. You know, your test starts, you know, train. I'm watching you in every aspect, how you train. I'm watching you from whatever time you come to the class. The test is that, okay, I want you to put it all together. And when I evaluate you, it's going to be not from this test here. It's going to be from what you've been doing so far. When you're going for a test, that means that from what I observe from you in your regular classroom setting, in your regular classroom environment, I'm saying you're ready now for your test from that point. So that's what I got from that. And I said, well, wow, you know, and then ever since there, I've been traveling. I was traveling with the sensei. You know, I went to Washington and went here, went to Pennsylvania. We went to Wigginton. We used to go to Wigginton School, and they used to come to us. And, I, you know, and that's how. And so that changed my whole outlook on things, you know. And from that point on, with it being Muslim and in the martial arts, just gave me another perspective on life.
How did you meet Dr. Moses Powell, and what made you want to learn Sanukis?
Well, let me just say this much. I didn't study directly with Mo, but I knew him. And I knew him, first of all, because him and Duncan were close friends. And not only him and Duncan, they used to call Duncan, they used to call Doc, and Elmo, Cleophas, the puppet, Cofield, Maynard, and Hamilton. Not Hamilton in particular, but those individuals, they used to call them the Brownsville boys and so forth, because they all grew up in Brownsville, East New York, and they were friends even before the martial art. They used to run together, all of them, Duncan and Doc, all of them good friends, you know. So from there, Duncan and Mo, they used to teach at St. John's Center. You know, they used to have segments over St. John's Center. Cofield, Mo, all of them used to be there. And Duncan used to go there and teach weaponry and so forth. And Doc, I met Doc closely from Duncan in that sense, not formally, but I knew of him. But then Doc knew of me when we used to do when Aaron Banks used to have the Oriental World of Self Defense, and then that's when I started really meeting all the brothers from Sanukis. You know, Anthony, well, Little John, Anthony. You know, I knew Pedro. Pedro and I were good friends. You know, close friends. Shaka, all good friends. Lumumba, good type. Sugar and I were schoolmates at Brooklyn College, and that's where we really got tight. And we used to, and along with other martial artists, started a martial art club in Brooklyn College. And Sugar and I used to exchange. We used to get on the mat and exchange with each other. My direct teacher, you know, where I studied directly from, was Latif Sadiq. Latif Sadiq was my connection, you know, directly with Sanukis. Now, later on, even in Doc's later years, I became even more closer to Doc. And that's when Ubaidah, Rahimahullah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him and grant him the Jannah. Then Ubaidah became close to Doc. And then I, you know, was in contact, me and Ubaidah was running together in Doc. And Doc, you know, he was at Ten Weir's dojo, but then before that, he used to come to Sugar's dojo, and I used to go there regularly. Also, you know, every so often I'd be at Sugar's dojo, and then Doc used to come through, give special seminars, you know, at Sugar's dojo on Clarkson, you know, and you became very, very close, you know. And Ubaidah used to always tell me, Doc, he used to tell me, come down, you know, he wants to see me, and, you know, things of that nature. And then there was a time, you know, that, he, you know, there was a little problem, not a problem, but he saw, Doc saw what I was about. He knew I was involved in the martial arts for a long time. And he, Ubeda said, you know, said that, you know, he wanted to see me about ranking me, you see, in that aspect, in the Sunuka. So, you know, Doc gave me my seventh dan, you know, and you know, I showed my certificate and so forth. I always kept these things to myself, you know, because, you know, that's the way I was, you know. You know, I appreciate people, sometimes people don't know what you know and who you know in that aspect. So there was some things rambling up, you know, so I said, well, let me show people, you know, my connection, because I'm old, you know, Sunuka's family, I'm close to most of the brothers in the Sunuka's family. I've gotten real close. Well, Saifa Law and we go way back. And Ubeda, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, you know, I mean, Ubeda was a student of Wigginton. That's me. I knew Ubeda since the 70s when we used to go to his school, you know, Wigginton school where he was training at, you know. I knew, and then Ubeda, when he came down to New York and Queens, so we ran together. Ubeda helped me in some projects, martial art projects that I have. I put him down on that. You know, we used to run together. We went to seminars, different Japanese seminars. I mean, we were running the gamut in the circuit. You know, so alhamdulillah, man, Doc gave me my seventh dan. And like I said, I put it up there, not to show, but just, you know, some, you know, like there was some ramblings about certain things that I'm having problems with. I don't want to air no dirty laundry. So I said, well, let me show people, look, you know, nobody can take no honor away from anybody. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives you honor. And even if Allah honors you, no one can dishonor you. When Allah gives you knowledge, no one can take that knowledge and what you have achieved in your life. So I just wanted to show. And at the same time, I want to show I'm connected to Sunukas in that sense. You know, I may not train directly, although, like I said, Latif Sardar, you can bear that out. Call him. He tells you. Anytime you see Latif Sardar, you know, together and say, Fallah tell you, say, yeah, that's my student there, you know. You know, I trained him, you know, and he did, you know, and that's where I got my connection is, you know. And then Soki Hassan, I've become even closer with him. I knew him for years. I've become close. I knew Anthony for years, and I knew Pedro before he passed. I knew Pedro a long time, you know, and a lot of other the Sunukas. Lumumba. You know, I know him for years. He works with me. I have a security company, and Mumu every year works with me. I mean, we close together. So I knew all, you know, a lot of the Sunukas people I knew, people from Cofield. You know, I knew people like Hawk Fraser, not personally, but not Hawk Fraser. La Puppet, I knew La Puppet personally. La Puppet, I think, used to come down to Duncan's dojo. I see, you know, used to train with him. You know, when he came, we had to leave, you know, because there was a special arrangement that was hooked up. So that's my connection with Doc, you know. And you know, I was I really got close to Doc afterwards, you know, in terms of my connection with him, and that's my history with that.
Now, Hans, yeah, I definitely hear a brotherhood between you and Senior Professor, and I'm gonna let you brothers rap. Trust me, I just got two more questions and I'm out the way. But this next question I have is crucial, because you actually sit in history. You sit at a very important place, because you was able to sit at the doorstep of two of the greatest, you know, two of the greatest martial artists, you know, in the 20th century. I mean, now me personally, you know, everybody has their own personal flavor. Now, for me, I propagate the language that, you know, Dr. Moses Powell was the greatest martial artist of the 20th century. And I'm sure, and I can quite see people, especially on the ninjutsu side, can say, yeah, but I feel you. But old sensei is my man, and I can get with that. But the way I want to set up this question is like this. I want to first set the paradigm in the Oriental. So we could say if Takada is to Aki Jiu-Jitsu, and then from Takada he had two top students, right? He had Ushiba, which went into Aikido, then he had the other guy who was a Korean, but he created Hapkido, right? Am I correct?
You're absolutely correct. Yes.
Right. So if you have these two students, both were disciples of Takada. And then if you bring it up to our legacy as you know, in the African American community, you could kind of say that Not saying that O-Sensei was a student of Professor V, but in a way you could say that Professor V, if you looked at him kind of like Takata, and then from him, let's say if you had these two great people, where one was Dr. Moses Powell and another one was O-Sensei Ronald Duncan, and these two men could easily, without a doubt, be said to be the, you know, the cornerstone of the African-American martial art community. When you look at these two great masters, what is the difference between their approach to martial arts and what's the difference between the ninjutsu as done by O-Sensei and the Sanuka's rule as done by Dr. Moses Powell?
Well, I would say this much. Like I said, I find two distinct characters, but two branches from the same tree. But at the same time, you know, branches give way to each other and they move out in different directions. But they're still part of the same root. The fact is that if as long as the branch stay connected to the tree and the tree is connected to the root, where the root is the area in which it's nourishing everything else, then you know, it's able to thrive. And that's the way I see. That's the way I see O-Sensei Duncan, and I see Moses. And they expressed. They went different routes in respect to the art, but they perfected. And they took on a certain character, and that character, they perfected that character, and it became unique. And I was saying, you know, that the black martial artists, the black masters during that time, did not get their due in recognition like they should have. And especially when it comes to, you know, O-Sensei, when it came to Mo, when it came to Fred Hamilton, you know, Kim Foye Padu, you know, George Cofield, Maynard Minor, and, you know, and K.A. and all these, and also Mufuni Asante, you know, who studied the Bandu system. All these black masters did not get, were not recognized and were not given their due during that time. So, you know, you had like what you consider a rebel type of, but control rebel type attitude and presentation from Duncan and Mo, in the sense that, you know, they took it to another level, to the point where even the Japanese had to recognize it. And what helped them to do that, to allow them to have like an incubator to really foster this particular presentation, was the Oriental World of Self-Defense. Before that, Duncan, and if I'm not mistaken, even Mo were in the when they had the World Fairs, the New York, when the World Fair came to New York, you know, Duncan was part of the Japanese pavilion, and he did his thing. If I'm not mistaken, Mo was part of that. Am I mistaken,
yes,
on that?
No, sir. That's your heart. You're right.
Right, you know.
Yes,
and so they were able to express, you know, this African approach to martial art. Although they stuck with tradition, they didn't take away, but it was a different flavor. And they had to do it in that sense because, you know, they used to say back in the times that I come in, well, if you don't study none of the Japanese, you haven't really studied no martial arts, which was a fallacy. So what happened was that Duncan knew Gil Noble. He's a very close friend to Gil Noble. Gil Noble wanted to do a special on the masters, the black masters of the martial arts. And he had Duncan and Mo, Maynard Minor, Cofield, the Puppet, Fred Hamilton, Mufuni, all these black martial artists on the East Coast did an exhibition on Like It Is. It was a two-parter. It was the most fantastic display of artistic expression in the martial art that I've ever seen. And when all these black masters came together, and there were students also that participated in it. So when you talk about two different, distinct, coming from the same root, expressing themselves in different directions, and then not only that, putting martial arts really on the map. They put it on the map, and when I looked at when I was training on Court Street, you had people from all persuasions coming to Duncan. You have people from all persuasions coming to Mo. You know, whites, blacks, Latinos. Even we had some Chinese and Japanese people coming, Philippine, all kind of people coming there. Because they put the martial on the map. They gave it another flavor. They gave it that African flavor. Elmo, you know, Cleophas Jacobs, all these people, man. They, you know, they were superb martial artists. I mean, traditional, you know, but at the same time, innovative in respect to how they wanted to present this art from a black perspective. Although it didn't take anything away from the traditional Japanese flavor or the Japanese aspect of it, but it just had a little tinge of rebellion because of the nature of how the situation was presented to us. They were ostracized in the what we would call the mainstream martial art media. Black Belt magazine, Karate Illustrated would not display any of the African American martial artists. Most of it was all white from the West Coast. They would get that billing from there. But then they developed a martial art magazine called Official Karate. That's when we were able to see some of our brothers, you know, being exhibited in the magazines. And then they down the line, when Duncan had introduced ninjutsu, they had Ninja magazine. And then Duncan used to get all his play from there. So that's what you get from these two extreme high professional warriors. You know, that's my take on it, inshallah.
Hanchi, my last two questions before I pass them to you, Professor Sipola. What is the difference between taijutsu, Aiki jujutsu, and ninjutsu?
Okay. Now, taijutsu is the form of fighting that comes out of ninjutsu. You know, taijutsu is what they call body art. You know, what it's saying is, just like all the other principles, it just has its different terms because of the nature of the method that's applied. Taijutsu is body art, meaning using your body as a weapon overall. So it incorporates kicking and punching and locks and throws. Now, when they say Duncan taijutsu, Duncan Taijutsu, D-A-K-E-N Taijutsu, it incorporates all those particular fighting systems. You know, that's the overall way it incorporates, you know, the aspect of punching, the aspect of kicking, the aspect of locks, and the aspects of throws and Tai Sabak movements, and also weaponry, and then the element of dealing with locks and throws and striking. You have Kopo Jitsu, which is the breaking of limbs and arms, and then you have the Kushu Jitsu, which is the striking of vital and nerve centers and vulnerable areas and so forth. So Taijutsu is no different in terms of its concept. When you say ninjutsu, it comes out of ninja. It's the fighting element, the technique aspect, the waza of ninjutsu. Aikijutsu has its approach in respect to the same thing. It just calls it another name, inshallah.
So my last question before I close out this segment and pass over to senior professor is, some consider Stephen Hayes the father of ninjutsu. What do you feel about that, and how does that relate to the position of old sensei Ronald Duncan?
Well, you know, and nothing taken away from Stephen Hayes, is very respectful martial artist, you know, of his time, but let's be for real. Let's deal with this thing historically. It's a media creation when they called him the father of American ninjutsu. That coin phrase was first given to Osensei because he's the first one. Nobody knew about ninjutsu until Professor Ronald Duncan brought it into play. Not to say that it was not documented, and you could have went and investigated. I mean, in Japan they were making films in the 50s and 60s, and they had ninjas in it. But as far as bringing it out to full display, it was never done until Professor Duncan brought it out in that light. And then his name basically came from when he was doing the Oriental World of Self-Defense, and he was displaying different forms of ninjutsu. Then, because of his introduction and his first exhibiting and bringing it out to the forefront, he became the father of American ninjutsu. It was always documented that way. It was always displayed in the magazines in that way. Stephen Hayes came afterwards. And he went to Japan to study with Hatsumi. Now, this is what we were told, that he at first wanted to come to Professor Duncan. He sent him a letter and everything, you know, and he wanted to be introduced to ninjutsu through him. But, you know, for whatever reason, it didn't happen. So from that point, he went to Japan, and then he was marketed by Hatsumi to come over here. Now, like I said, nothing taken away from Professor Stephen Hayes. He's a good martial artist. I respect him, but I'm just giving you, you know, the historical data in this respect. So that phrase was him being the father of American ninjutsu. That's a media creation. Duncan, that was given to him because of what he had exhibited, you know, in the martial art world for years. Now Duncan is way older than Stephen Hayes when it comes to the martial arts. I don't know in terms of age, but I know Stephen Hayes is a later creation. Duncan has been around in the early 50s, even, you know, and so forth. And he trained even before then.
I want to thank you, Hachi, for this interview, for the first half. To the guest listeners, 646-716-6825. We're talking to the legendary Ali Abdul-Karim, ninjutsu master, and a very elite martial artist, just period. Before I go into this, before I pass over to my guest, co-host, Senior Professor Saifullah of the Sanuka's Rule System, a Sanuka's Rule master who will take us into a deeper conversation of Hanchi Ali. In this show, I'm also trying to attract the younger generation, my generation, to these arts, and it's on our shoulders to learn from these great masters and pass it on to the future masters. So I'm just going to take 1 minute, allow my guest host, Senior Professor Saifullah, allow my guest, Hanchi Ali, to kind of just relax for about a minute or two. When the music goes, I'll bring it back into the next segment, and Senior Professor Saifullah will take it over.
La música de Harry Fry. Shabbat show. We have our guest, Hanchi Ali Abdul-Karim. We're now going into the second format of the show. We have about 1 hour and 4 minutes left. I mean, man, this was just a great interview. Next, my guest co-host, Senior Professor Saifullah Mariki, a master in the Sanuka's Rule System, Dr. Moses Powell, will be taking over. And I would just want to just say that I want to give Senior Professor at least about maybe 30 minutes, 35 minutes for his questioning, and then from there, I want to jump into the clips with Hanchi and then also maybe take some calls. So I think if I could say for a while, I'm going to pass it over to you to start your question.
Bismillah. As-salamu
alaykum. Wa alaykum as-salam, my brother.
I just wanted to start by thanking the host of the show, the Farrakhan Shabazz Show. By thanking him. As you know, this is a very good opportunity to let the audience and the people know, you know, that even though you hear me also co-hosting on the Gilaw First, which used to be the Senju Kai Warrior Within talk show, we're still, as you see, unified and working together and helping and assisting one another whenever we can. So this is a wonderful opportunity for people to see that and dispel any rumors that may be out there that, you know, we're divided and we can't get along. No, we can better serve the public at large. I like the direction that the show that Brother Farrakhan is going in, and he wants to appeal to a larger of the martial art community, with, as you see, along with Sue Nukas, Rujitsu, and with Ninjitsu, and many other martial arts that he's bringing to the forefront, to the light, for the people to better have an understanding of what's available to them. So I appreciate that very, very much, Farrakhan. And also, I wanted to also make, he mentioned there were two living legends. I don't consider myself to that degree yet. I'm just a little guy trying to do a lot of big things with the permission of the Creator. What I do want to take you to grab a solid point, a point that you made earlier. Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
Yeah, when you mentioned Chunzba, isn't that also Chunzba, which comes with, we know it comes from the Chinese, isn't that also, along with striking, an art that that the Okinawans and later on, you know, the Japanese and those who are practitioners of ninjutsu utilized for joint locking,
right,
and joint manipulation. Could you elaborate a little bit on this for us?
Right. Well, again, you know, you got to understand during that time, the art of the time was jujitsu, the old form of samurai jujitsu. And, you know, being the ninja were Japanese, they also were able to absorb fighting systems, you know, from different fighting forms. And yes, and it's the same. It's the same movements that you will find, the same Taisabak movements that you will find in Jiu-Jitsu and Aikijitsu and Daitoru, you know, Jiu-Jitsu, and then later on the earlier contemporary, you know, like Haikoru Jiu-Jitsu, which is an earlier form of Jiu-Jitsu. And it would incorporate all these particular aspects because the ninja was, you know, they were part of the Japanese environment. They were Japanese. Later on, as time progressed and the shogun would see the expertise, how the ninjas would protect themselves, then they were employed by the shogun to be part of his entourage. They were the elitist part of the military, part of the shogun's army, you know.
Right.
And they also learned. Then the ninjas began to learn samurai forms and kenjutsu and aikijutsu, and they began to learn aido, you know, aido jutsu, the sword, the drawing a sword and different sword play. And they learned also, you know, more classical forms of jujitsu. And then from there, the samurai became ninjas, and then vice versa. So, yes, the same locks and the same approach to jujitsu, as you see it in the classical forms and the ancient forms, was also incorporated and employed by the ninjas, by the shinobi.
This is fascinating. I remember the question Farrakhan asked about what's distinguished ninjutsu, or even we say, I like to say the ninja, from the other martial arts. And what about the fact that the ninja was known also to be known for his stealth movements, you know, also known to be a hired assassin, you know? What about this aspect? Because I think this dark element, or is this a myth, or is this a true element of what entailed in the life of being a ninja?
Well, that, you know, we used to say that the dark side, but it's really and the thing about it is, it's not really the dark side in a sense. It's the approach has this dark element to it, but it's part of warfare. You got to understand, during that time, in every nation from that time up until today have their assassination aspect to it. And it's just like we have today. We have snipers. You know, we have snipers. We have stealth organizations like the CIA who do their stealth assignments and missions. You have, during that time, the ninjas were part of that. Now, see, the ninjas were not, although they did, some of them did fighting the battles, but they were not battle condition individuals. They were not used as battlefield soldiers. They were used to gather information. That was their main function, was to spy, was to get in, find out what the enemy is planning, and that's why they were able to climb. That's why they were into climbing. That's why they were had the high science of camouflaging and blending in, you know, with nature to conceal themselves. And this allowed the Shogun to find out what was going on within the castles of his enemy. And when it took got to the extent where they wanted to eliminate a certain element within the Shogun's, the other enemy's guard, they would send the ninjas to do that. But it was all part of warfare. You know, the assassination part was part of what we have today. What every nation has is that elite element, Navy SEALs, the Rangers, the Delta Force. These are all ninja-orientated, forces that they got this. Basically, the military that's employing these type of tactics got this from the ninjas, and they studied that. Now they just got a film out. They showed it on. I saw it on YouTube. Put it on my Facebook, and they showed it on CNN about ninja women, or what we call konoichi in Iran, practicing ninjutsu. They say thousands of women. So it's the ninjutsu in that part of it. Where they call the art of elimination by stealthy means has always been part of every nation, but the Japanese perfected it in that regard. So that's dealing with it. But it's always part of warfare. They didn't just go out and just for the sake of assassination. They did it because that was their assignment, and that was part of their mission.
Now, we talked about Dr. Moses Powell and his Sanukis, and old sensei Ronald Duncan and his ninjutsu. Could we say, would it be possible to say that the both of them were a different, were made of a different aspect of Bruce Lee? Bruce Lee. He brought to the public Kung Fu, which was a hidden form for the Chinese. Chinese kept it underground for many, many centuries, and especially in America. And then he exposed this art. One of the things that got him in trouble, with his own community.
Right.
So this aspect, we would say, could we say that Grandmaster Ronald Duncan did the same thing with ninjutsu, which was underground in America, hidden out to the public, and then here comes a man of expertise in this martial art, and he brings this out. So he exposes it and brings it to the public light. And the other side of Bruce Lee is the fact that he was the founder from he Wing Chun he has, and he develops now Wing Jeet Kune Do.
Right.
Well, Dr. Moses Powell has, Vichitsu Tei, Vichitsu Ru, which has its foundations in the Philippine martial arts and jiu-jitsu. And then he takes and revolutionizes it just because prior to Dr. Moses Powell, we have the language of falling. And with Sanukis, we have now the language of we don't learn how to fall, we learn how to land.
Right.
When I teach my students, I always say to my students, I say, what you prefer to do? If you're in a plane, would you want to land out the sky? Would you want to fall out the sky? So the difference. Here, he revolutionized and even used the rollout as a weapon.
Right.
So nobody had said this before. And then in the movements that he put together, the way he put the system together, the Adai system of Sanukis, he revolutionized jiu-jitsu. So would that be a good analogy to say that both of these great martial artists from here on the shores of America were able to take an aspect, both each of them, an aspect of Bruce Lee, and go far and into the martial arts realm to help enhance all of us that practice the martial arts?
That's an exact depiction of historical evolution of both these two great masters, and that's exactly what you get. You know, you get two individuals like Bruce Lee, who started thinking outside the box. You know, he in other words, when you get into aspects like this, like martial arts, your horizon begins to expand and it rises up. You know, you find that in some respect, traditionally, the Japanese, when they develop certain systems, they want to keep it to that level. When you find, that's why we have innovation. In the martial art, there's room for innovation. You know, and this is why people begin to say, well, you know, that doesn't look like jiu-jitsu. That doesn't, you know, no, it's not. That's not the point. The point is that can we continue to perfect what we're doing? Can you build on? Does it mean that this is it? And if that was the case, we wouldn't have karate, Shotokan karate. We wouldn't have, you know, Daitoru jiu-jitsu and Aikijitsu and Aikido and all these other forms and Goju and so forth. And you can just go down the line and have Hapkido and Taekwondo. These are elements that came out of the traditional systems, and these are men that had vision and expanded that vision by developing, you know, other aspects. It doesn't take away from the system. The root is the system. That's what I'm saying. It's like this is all boils down to a tree and its roots and the branches that it produces. So yes, your depiction and your analysis is to me right on point. That yes, Duncan and Mo's approach to the martial art is just like Bruce Lee's approach, and that's why we have these two great systems, you know, that exist. And that's why, and if you notice, systems only last and they only flourishes if they have good, solid principles behind it. And working principles that you can apply at any given time in any period of time. You know, those systems that did not adapt, you know, and we get history. The samurais that did not adapt to the changing of the weapons when it went from the sword to the gun, to the rifle, they didn't survive because they wanted the whole long tradition. No, that's why the ninjas survived, because the ninjas said, okay, this is the weapon of today. Well, this is what I'm going to perfect myself into. And that's why we're telling some of these ninjutsu practitioners who say, well, you know, that's not it. Don't tell me it's not. When you develop and you innovate, as long as you do it under the guise of making the adaptation from the system that you're coming out, and you have to adapt to the time, that comes under the principles that the ninjas and the old jujitsu masters that branch out, that comes under their principle. So you're following their principle. You're not just following traditional methods of which they employed then, but you're following the overall principle is to learn to adapt. So if the weapon of today is an M16 and it's a 9mm and it's this weapon and that weapon, then you have to adapt. And you have to make your art fit the period of time that you live in it. So you are following the traditional way of the ninjas, because that's what they did. You know, the ninjas employed cannons and projectile weapons and so forth. So they didn't just use swords, you know, fire bombs and explosive powder, you know. So they were very innovative, and they were very unorthodox. That's how they survived. So, yes, I say the same thing, yeah, that you're saying. You know, I concur.
Yes, sir. You remind me of I have to share the story with the audience, you and the audience, what you just said about, you know, after adapted to change. Sensei Usman Abdul Salam, who was a student at the Tang Dojo under Grandmaster George Cofield, also training under Grandmaster Thomas LePuppet, he taught down in Philadelphia. And he was my breath of fresh air for me, because he was like, you know, my New York school here,
right,
in Philadelphia, where I could train, continue my training. And one morning we were talking, he liked to go and have a meal in the morning time. And he was talking one morning, he said, yeah, you know, I was walking down the street, and I was going on the way to the dojo, because he lived in the dojo. He said, I went to have my breakfast going back, and one guy jumped in front of me and said, oh, sensei, sensei, bullseye, pull my gun out on you. What you going to do then? He said, well, I'm pulling my gun out and shoot you. He said, you ain't going to say that. So I was just saying, you know, a lot of people think, you know, the martial we don't adapt. And
right.
I have a course that I do in my dojo that we have called Gun Fu, you know.
Right. That's right. Absolutely.
Because, it's something that we, you know, we it's a reality. It is, a, you know, part of the martial arts also. But I wanted to bring back a point that you were talking about, along with Shabazz, as far as the father of Ninjitsu. Now, we have to look. We're not living in the body, but the truth has to be told. We didn't know nothing, like you said, about ninjutsu until old Sensei Ronald Duncan came and brought students like yourself out, James Loriega, you remember these names?
That's right. That's right.
Alibaba.
Right. That's right, brother. That's right. I'm glad you added that. I, you know, like, it kind of escaped me, but I'm glad you brought them those two definite warriors in
Phillips,
into the picture.
Phillips Vasquez.
Phillips Vasquez. That's
you know,
right.
David. Wayne Brooks.
Right.
You know these names that you know that kind of you know. Well, Phillips. I was just doing a seminar with him. Wonderful. He's still out there. But names that you know. Richard Wigginton,
right.
that need to be echoed because these are the people that came way before Stephen Hayes.
Absolutely.
And they came through Ronald Duncan. And we didn't know about Kogaru or Iga. We didn't know about that, you know. You may have to correct me, but I do believe that Stephen Hayes is under the Iga family.
Right, Bujikan.
Right, and old sensei is under the Koga. So can you explain these two families, the Iga and Koga,
right.
and a little history of about the two of these roots?
Well, yeah, and you got to remember that Koga and Iga are provinces in Japan.
Those.
You know, and it's just that, you know, these provinces is where these certain elements of the ninjas came from, the Iga province and the Koga province. And that's what they were known under in terms of their province or where they came from. The techniques are basically the same. The techniques, the approach, the method, the concepts, the principles, the assignments, and all what they employed are basically the same. You'll find really no different. Now, the Koga might specialize in certain aspects of the fighting system. Some would say, and I'm just saying historically, I'm not saying that I am of this thinking, but some would say, and not because I'm affiliated with this particular concept or school of thought, some were saying that the Koga is practiced in higher form, you know, of ninjutsu, you know. But that's, you know, that's something that's said in terms of historically, but they both were proficient in their arts, and they fought against each other. And you know, one of the emperors during Japan's time, I think it was I can't remember the I know the name I don't want to mispronounce it.
Yes, sir.
But the point is that he destroyed the Iga, and it was that with the help of the Koga, they destroyed some of the Iga families, and from that point he went to destroy them or eliminate them because of whatever reason. But the point is that they were both clans were for proficient in the higher form and science of shinobi no jutsu, you know, ninjutsu in its contemporary name. So that's what you get from that.
When you said science, this is my next point that I want to bring into go into with you, so you can clarify these elements and some historical facts. Was it the practice of the ninja clan to accept orphans you know, young youth children in the age of from maybe 4, 5, 6, 7 on up that didn't have any parents. They were off. They lost their parents, and they would take these children to train them. And they would, and then some of the training methods, which I was going to speak about, where they would first they would bath them in severe cold water, you know, train them to adapt to the weather conditions, you know. And what is there a special a passageway or a special a path of permission, like the picture of Kung Fu? You know, it's like Lon King, he waited outside, and he had to say the right words or have the right etiquette to be accepted into the monastery. How was it for the ninja? What was it to be accepted into a ninja guru?
Right. Now, first of all, the ninjas, in terms of them being a clan, and that's what it was, a ninja clan, you know, it was a family in a village. You know, it was basically a family affair. Most people who are part of the ninjutsu family or the shinobi family were born in the family. You know, it was an extremely, extremely secretive society, you know, where nobody would be able to penetrate. You couldn't spy on the spies. You know, they were proficient in that respect. If, in fact, there was, say, an extraordinary circumstances where a child could have been adopted, and they've taken them in into the clan, then quite naturally they would have taught, you know, that child. Those situations were very rare because they wanted to always keep ninjutsu within the family, extremely, extremely secretive. And just like you said, that you know, there's no, you know, in reality, there's no basics in ninjutsu. Ninjutsu, and every aspect of his training, is a high form of training. And the reason why I say that is that, according to historical data, when the baby was born, the ninja father used to take the baby and submerge it into water right after the birth, knowing that the baby would swim and survive because it just came out of that environment. Now, that's a high form of training, to take an infant child and submerge it in water right after its birth is a high form of training. And in most cases, it was like, can this baby survive? Because, you know, you have in certain, even today, in certain primitive practices and ancient practices, you know, like even the, they were saying the Spartans, you know, the Greeks, you know, they did that, you know, with their children, you know, to see if, you know, the child is born. If a child is born weak, then the child could not survive, you know. So the ninjas, they did the same thing. And then the child from its growing to, you know, to a childhood and to adolescence, they were trained in climbing trees and camouflage. You know, these are high forms of training. It's not like basics like we would do, you know, in a school and start a person out to teach them how to do a horse stands or front stands. They go right into high form of training. So really there's no basic. We have to create a basic standard for people who come in, because they couldn't deal with, you know, because the people were not conditioned, not like the environment that the ninjas came on. They were already in a rugged environment, so they were already rugged people. But, you know, like today in this contemporary time, we have to bring people up to speed in respect to training. You know, so we would have to create basics for them. So I have a segment where I teach the person, at least once they get to a point where they understand balance and form and posture and striking, then they can go right into the high form of the techniques, at least beyond what normal schools would do. You know, we go right into training them to fight. And the individual that I was speaking about that invaded the Iga province was Oda Nobunaga, Nobunaga. You know, he was the one that had this thing, and this is during the Tagoru province and, period, where he went in and destroyed the Iga province and wiped it out. And some of the ninjas escaped, and some of them, were very vindictive against us. And this is where, the story is of Hattori Hanzo. This is where that comes out of. But not to digress. Yes, the ninjas taught their child from childhood on up, from childbirth on up. And again, I reiterate that if, in fact, that there was a child that they had taken in as an orphan, that child would definitely be trained under ninjutsu as well.
I said scientific because now what you just said is fascinating, because you think of it nowadays at the commercial martial art, commercial martial way schools. I don't call them martial art. I call them martial way schools. Because they try to follow the way of the martial artists, mm-hmm. but they're martial way schools because they're commercialized. They're making money. That's what their main goal is, not to preserve lives. That's secondary. But listen at what you just said, and I hope the audience captured that. The fact that nowadays, not too long ago, doctors were saying it's okay to take babies to YMCAs and have them learn how to mm-hmm. swim, when the ninjas were doing this many centuries ago.
Yes, that's absolutely.
They had the knowledge of poisons. They had the knowledge of how to dislocate their bodies if they were locked up.
Yes.
And how to get out and put their bones back together again.
Yes.
So this is not just, people have to look at this, the art of not only being able to injure somebody, but also the art of healing was involved in this.
Exactly. And you're talking about a people who studied the anatomy inside and out and its ability and what is capable. That's the thing. What is the body capable of doing and how much can the body endure? And these people, and then the feats that they could have accomplished, jumping great heights, running long distances, miles and miles, to get to one province to other. There was no trains and there was no phones and, no computers. I mean, these people did everything, through physical means. And these are people who studied themselves and studied inside the mind. What is the mind capable of doing? That's why they developed a certain sense of perception. People really don't realize what modern military doing today is trying to emulate. And trying to imitate what the ninjas did then and what they were capable of doing. They're trying to do it, and they're trying to do this with the modern technology that they have. But the point is that the ninjas didn't have this modern day technology. Just like the pyramids in Egypt and all these others, the Mayas, and the Aztecs and all these people who built great artifacts and great buildings and pyramids. People wanted today without any technology that did exist like it exists today,
You're taking this to Africa, sir.
This is where it all came from, brother.
It's a good thing that there. Here we go. That's another point. Well, remember the day I wanted to bring about the Manza, and Shabazz would really appreciate this, the Zulu warriors,
yes.
Shaka Zulu, his
exactly.
warriors. They said they would run hundreds of miles to a battle and
that's
die.
Right.
And the
That's
people
right.
could hear them coming from hundreds of miles, and they would strike fear in the enemy coming as they heard them coming to the battle. So this it's one that, again, how these ninjas were trained warriors.
Yeah.
Now
yeah.
you have to address this issue before we get into a few more questions that are hot. But this issue, let's deal with it. We look in the movies, and we see the ninja. Now he's, look at this last Ninja Assassin's latest movie,
mm-hmm.
right? He's a ninja, a rogue ninja. He's, and all of these ninjas, they don't send one. They send all these ninjas after him.
Mm-hmm.
And when we look at the earlier movies, the samurai, mm-hmm. whenever we see a samurai,
in most instances, it's either one walking like the baby car series, smoking assassins.
Mm-hmm.
But you see all these ninjas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, very rarely you see one ninja with one opponent.
Mm-hmm.
Is this a myth, or is this was there a method, a reason for the ninja utilizing this method of using so many to get to do the job?
Right. Well, it's a Hollywood invention, and it's a Hollywood version of the ninjas. Let me tell you something. All this stuff, you know, where you see the samurais, you know, just taking out the ninjas. See, you in most cases, historically, you would not see the ninja until he, you know, accomplished, or you would feel the effect of a ninja. You know, you would not, you know, the ninja was not in the business of facing his opponent. The only time he would come across that instance if he was in the situation where he was spying in the castle and he was discovered. Then he would have to deal with the situation. But you have to understand, the ninja was full of tricks. His whole concept and principle of fighting was to evasion. And his technique reflected that point of evasion. All his techniques were based on not being confined. So he had all the instruments that would allow him and afforded him not to be captured. His techniques reflect the same thing, stealth. His technique respects stealth. You don't see him boxing his opponent. Sword play. He knew the samurai was much more versed than he was in the art of swordsmanship. He would not confront his opponent in that fashion, although in later times he became samurai. And the samurai became ninja. But his fighting methods were still the same. He would not fight fair. That's the bottom line. You know, the samurai had a code of Bushido code. And that Bushido code means face your enemy, the best man win. That was not the ninja was not under the code. The code the ninja was under, win by whatever means necessary. So that's why they had all kind of tricks. If a samurai came up and I throw poison powder, blinding powder in your face, you know, that's it. And then I proceed, either I escape or I eliminate and terminate you. So there was no fair fighting. So in most cases, when you see these Hollywood versions where the ninjas drop down from the ceiling and the samurai just cuts them up, most times ninjas did not expose themselves. When the ninja, when you dealt with the ninja, he had enough in his arsenal to do things at a distance, like a sniper. You know, a sniper is a stealth person. You will only feel the effect of a sniper, but you will not see a sniper.
Well, see, I have abated myself, Rahimullah. We had a discussion back in the early 80s. We came across a book, Secrets of the Vagabond.
Right.
In there, they were dealt with the fact that, you know, the Chinese also had their form of ninjutsu.
Exactly.
Could you expound a little bit on this, and which came first?
Right.
The Chinese or the Japanese version?
Well, in most instances, the Chinese had developed martial arts way before the Japanese. And like I said, the Japanese borrowed, although the Japanese, there's certain culture, fighting culture, that they had already had. You know, they can't take anything from the samurai period. You know, they developed that own from their own. But the empty hand aspect of it, a lot of it came from the Chinese province. Vagabonds were robbers, were thieves. And in terms of the Chinese, that's what they call them, vagabonds, because they were, you know, people who were up in the mountains and in the woods and so forth, and they would rob, you know, caravans and individuals. But what they did was they used trickery to do that. They used trickery and certain methods that ninjas use today. The ninjutsu aspect of the vagabonds or the Chinese came first, and that's why I say once some of the Japanese to escape persecution went up into the mountains and met up with some of these individuals, and they were taught these particular methods of fighting and the methods of espionage and sabotage and things and assassination and so forth. So that's when the vagabonds were Chinese, but they were mostly, you know, highway robbers, you know, you know, and they were brigands, you know, as they would call them in Britain, you know, and they would go and they would use tricks, certain tricks, and those tricks the Japanese adapted and they perfected it. Now the vagabonds and using those tricks, it wasn't, you know, the Japanese, they always document this stuff and they always formulated and put it in a structure, and it became a structure and it became an art in a school and a method and so forth. The vagabonds were just people who were just using this thing to, you know, to rob and to, you know, and so forth to survive. So yeah, the vagabonds, the Chinese method, according to historical data, was the first to incorporate these type of methods of ninjutsu or shinobi.
Well, this is very interesting. Now, coming into the fact that you said you accepted Islam, as we know that for us, you know, we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone.
Ameen.
Without any partners or associates.
Without any association. Ameen.
Now, the martial artist, he comes in the martial arts, he's trying to study traditional martial arts, and he comes in and he studies, and, you know, they have a bowing procedure, and, you know, they're bowing to the ancestors and the ones who came before them, giving respect and all that kind of stuff. As Muslims, we don't participate in that.
Absolutely.
We bow only down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Right.
There's an aspect now where we say the martial art is built on the from the physical, mental, and spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
For us, our spiritual is al-Islam.
Right.
But for the different other martial arts, maybe Shintoism, Buddhism, or, you know, whatever is coming along, Confucianism, you know, that's coming along with that particular martial art. The ninja had something to say they used to do with their hand.
Right.
And calling or recite or some kind of connotation they would recite.
Mm-hmm.
It is said that this is call on spirits to assist them. You know, in Islam we say, you know, they're calling on the jinn.
Right.
You know, to help them other than calling on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Could you expound on this a little bit for us, please?
Right. Well, you hit it right on the head as a Muslim. You know, religiously, you know, we are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in respect to how we conduct ourselves in terms of worship. And we don't indulge in anything outside of, in terms of the spiritual or the religious aspect of it. We eliminate that aspect because it is an aspect that is in contrast to Islamic teachings. And there is what they call kujikiri. Kujikiri is a aesthetic practice which, you know, they perform an array of hand seals, what they call kujin, was meant to allow the ninjas to like enact superhuman feats. And they would do this in this. It's called the kuji. Is like considered like nine characters, and the concept of it originated from Taoism. Taoism is, you know, the study of Tao. Tao is, you know, monks and so forth that study these mystical arts, and it's like a stern of nine words used in charms and incantations. You know, again, calling, like you say, calling on certain spiritual. You'll find in terms of Chinese tradition, it has a mixture of Buddhism beliefs in it, so forth, you know. And with an understanding that each of those nine words is like a Buddhist deity. And so the Kuji may have like arrived in Japan in Buddhism where it flourished. So the thing is that being that these signs and these practices are religious and in nature, spirit in terms of what they considered spiritual, and they're really the act of them is basically like sorcery, magic. So we don't indulge in these aspects of it. That's eliminated. We like you say, in respect to bound, we say that we stand for Allah, we bow for Allah, and we prostrate for Allah. So anything that is connected to the worship of Allah in our rituals, in our practice, is only exclusively for Allah. So we cannot use those means, those same positions for anything other than Allah. So when people say, well, I'm just bowing, it's just a greeting, but the form that you're taking is taking in that form is also applied in our salah. So we can't substitute, and there's no substitute for that form to anything other than Allah. So we don't bow, you know. We don't stand up, you know, for anyone, even the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't stand, except in some cases he made a stand up for the sheikh out of respect, this and that, but it wasn't like something like the sunnah. It wasn't something that he established to do. You know, he just respect. When a funeral procession came by, he stood up out of respect, you know, but it wasn't something that out of worship or anything of that nature. So we eliminate anything that has any religious connotation to it. If it has any religious connotation, we don't partake in it, and that's it. And definitely, the kujikiri is a method in which they call on the jinns. And bottom line, they call on these spirits and things, and I think to make them strong. We don't need to do that. We have another aspect of understanding. All you got to do, you know, in terms of spiritual, you give all your allegiance to your Creator, Allah, and you have all these internal strength and methods that's going throughout your body. You just have to tap into it. You don't need to call any demons or any other spiritual aspect. You just call on your Lord, and you have the right mind. You eat right, you live right, and you worship, and you do righteous things. And when you're looking for something like that in solutions, it will come to you based on your righteousness in that sense. So we don't use these particular methods in my school or in most Muslim schools that I know follow the same pattern of thinking.
Just two more questions, and if two more.
We have two more minutes in this segment before we move on to him talking about the demo. This is clip.
Okay, right. Okay. Just give us 4 minutes. I will give him 2 minutes to answer these questions. Just take 2 minutes to answer each of these questions. That's my last two questions I have here. The first one is dealing with, and you can answer them both together if you want, dealing with you've been instrumental in the Islamic community for a long time, and you're demonstrating with Grandmaster Ronald Duncan doing the Oriental Self-Defense. As long as you've been involved, and we've been known for you to do this, and I hope that you continue to do this. Could you go into, because it's on Facebook, and since they brought it out, you know, that he has now banned, dismissed you, or put you out of the his organization. Could you briefly just tell us what that is about? And the second question is, what was it like, you know, for you and of course Abu Beda, when we were going to the first World Trade Center, and Abu Beda had to, you know, go, you know, yourself helping Ken to help clarify some things in the situation with Abu Beda at that time. That's my last two questions.
Right. Now, throughout history, there's always been cases when teachers and students have certain differences, and whatever differences, how whatever forms that take. With myself and my teacher, you know, there are some ideological differences that we've had, and when it comes to my religion, it's first and foremost. And because somebody may not be Muslim, may misunderstand what my posture and my position is, and then it may come to a point where we clash in that respect. And that's what happened. You know, there's a certain belief that I have that I'm not in no way going to compromise or give up. And that's basically the kind of encounter we have. So in that sense, if a person opposite that feels that they can't come to grips with that, or they can't cope with that, then quite naturally they want to sever, you know, those kind of ties, you know, and that's what it is. I stand on principles, Islamic principles, and I only worship one God, and nobody else. And then I appreciate everybody else that gives, because I'm always letting people know my knowledge comes from God through people, and knowledge is the property of all believers, and they claim it wherever they find it, and they understand that no one can take this from them. And this is not a boast, and I'm humbly trying to say this, but whatever I've accomplished because I put the time in and I paid my dues. And when you do it to that point, and when you get to the extent of that, and you come in, and I'm 41, over almost 42 years in respect to this martial art, that I've, by Allah's permission, I've accomplished whatever I've accomplished. No one can come by and wave their hand over and said it disappears. You can't. No, it's impossible. It's unreasonable. It's illogical to do that kind of thing. So I have respect for my teacher at all times. He'll still be my father in the martial arts, but I have my own personal outlook on life, and I'm not harming nobody. But I do stand on my religion, and I stand firmly on that. If you cannot deal with it, it's no problem. You have a right not to be able to deal with it. But you can't tell me not to deal with it, because this is my way of life. So what have I accomplished? That's why I had to display that I've been dealing with other systems and other people, and I've been given my Hanshi degree from all the organizations that reckon that's all that's required in the martial arts. You know, when you get to a certain point in your martial art, you know, you're an honorary. Everything is honorary from this point, and everything is recognition. I mean, it goes back to say, if Yushaba, the founder of Aikido, and his old jiu-jitsu teacher, Daitoru, the jiu-jitsu teacher, came to him, and all he has accomplished, and he built his own, come to him and say, well, you're no longer part of this and this and that. That's unreasonable. How can this man, you know, he's not a white belt or a green belt or a showdown where you can say, well, I'm taking your rank from you or whatever. You can't. I mean, I'm
respectfully, so we have 30 seconds. I've got to get you.
Okay. All right. So, you know, I just wanted to get that out, inshallah.
Any other question for the senior professor? The other answer to the other question is about Abu Beda.
Oh, Abu Beda, in terms of my relationship with him?
The work that you did to help him with Ken, the lawyer, and
oh yeah. Well, you know, I'm a private investigator, and I was dealing with the World Trade Center cases, and there was a brother that I've known dearly. His name is Dr. Rashid. We used to call him Dr. Rashid. His name was Clampton L. And I was on his case. I was hired, you know, to deal with the World Trade Center case, and I was hired. And Ubeda, you know, had in close contact with the brother, and they were trying to link him, you know, to certain activities that were supposed to be going on with the brother. But Ubeda was exonerated from that. They got him on some other lesser charges and all that. But you know, that's basically what it is, you know.
Shukran, and I thank you both for allowing me this time, and we turn the show back over to the host, Professor Bass. Thank you very much.
Alhamdulillah, I appreciate you being here, Aki.
I appreciate you all.
Thank you so much, Senior Professor. Walaikum salam, sir. Senior Professor Sam Maliki from the World Within. I thank you so much for being a guest co-host on the show. Okay. Hanshi Ali Abdul Kareem. How you feeling? How you feeling, sir?
Oh, very good, man, and you know, very, very appreciative to have this chance, you know, to be part of your show and to basically appeal to the audience, inshallah.
Okay, all right. Well, so before I go into this new format, basically, what I want the audience to do is especially I get a lot of archive listens. So if you can go to youtube.com, and you're gonna type in Kempo Taijitsu, and then you're going to type the number 2. So it's K-E-M-P-O space T-A-I-J-U-T-S-U space and the number 2. Okay? So you're going to pull that clip up. All right. Now, Hanshi, before you go into this, because what I'm going to have you do is give me the because we only have 13 minutes left. So
right.
I'm gonna play the clip so they can hear it. But then, and I want you to just give me in about a minute and a half after I play the clip. I want you to give me the philosophy of your movement. I want you to give me the at Hachi level. I want you to give me the philosophy of your martial expression in terms of what you were trying to express through that uki. Okay. But before we go into that, because we have 13 minutes left, just give me your dojo information, your contact information, because once we get into this, I'm sure the show is going to kind of go fast after that. So just kind of tell them where they can find you at your dojo. Just take like a minute to do that, please.
Okay. My dojo is at Bedford, on the corner of Bedford and Fulton. It's at the mosque. We have our dojo inside the mosque downstairs in the basement. I have one, it's a separate in terms of classroom. And it's 1266 Bedford Avenue, and that's the corner of Bedford and Fulton. The A train, the C train, and the shuttle. The A train to Nostrand Avenue. The C train, if it's running local, is to Franklin Avenue. Walk up to Bedford, and the shuttle to Franklin Avenue and walk up to Bedford. The entrance is on Brevoort. It's around the corner from the mosque, and go downstairs. My number in terms of contacting me is 347-612-8796. You can go to my Facebook, Ali Abdul Karim Hanshi, and if you can request for me to give you the schedule, and I'll forward it to you. But the schedule is Wednesdays 7:30 to 10, Saturday and Sundays 12 to 2:30.
Okay. So without any further ado, so the clip that I gave you was called Kempo Space Taijutsu. That's T-A-I-J-U-T-S-U and the number 2. So you go to YouTube, type in Kempo Space Taijutsu Space the number 2, and you're going to get this clip. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to play this clip, and it's a minute and 36 seconds, and then I'm going to let the Hanshi give a philosophical expression of what he was trying to express through this uki. And I'm going to basically, because we only got 11 minutes left, so this is going to be it. I'm not going to get to the other clip. And I'm going to just play this clip, and I'm going to let him take us out with his philosophy of his expression. Let me just first play the clip.
You need to minimize, neutralize. This is the concept. You need to neutralize the momentum. Because if you give your opponent the ability to generate more power, so that means that if he attacks him, He attacks. He's building. If I move back and continue to give him space, momentum, he's building up momentum. His force is greater than mine because he's already in motion. He's already revved up. So for me to equalize the situation, I have to minimize the force that's being generated. So I can't, if I keep backing up, he's just coming and the person's coming and more force is generated. This again. What I'm doing is not even there.
Oh, stop. And man, if you get a chance to look at that clip, some devastating throws. I mean, just devastating movements. And Hachi, we got 9 minutes left. And before you get into the philosophy of what you was doing with that uki, can you just take about 30 seconds and tell us about the experience with you and CJ Motaka Bear in terms of when you guys was cleaning up the drug dealers out of Brooklyn and Queens? Just take like 30 seconds just to kind of touch on it.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, we had started in Brooklyn first to start cleaning up the drugs in Bedford-Stuyvesant, right where the mosque is at, Bedford-Fulton. So what happened was it caught on to every other place. Everybody else started to now be conscientious and needed to do the same thing and duplicate what we did on Bedford and Fulton. So being masters and Muslims, we all connected, and we all started to networking. So with Sijo, you know, Mukta Kabir and other brothers that we are connected with, we win Ramadan, and all these other brothers, we went. They called us, and we wanted to do this, duplicate and do the same thing that we did in Brooklyn. So we went over there to their masjid, and other masjids called us out, and we went over there, and we stood up the same way we stood up for the drugs in Bed-Stuy. We did it in Queens, and we were able to clean it up. We assisted each other in these matters. So, and that's how we became real close, you know, from that time on. And although I knew Seju Mutakabir way before that, doing the martial art community, I knew him more when we did this and embarked on this collective effort to clean up the drugs in our neighborhood.
And without any further ado, Hanchi, we got 7 minutes. I'm going to let you ride the show out. The clip was Kenpo Taijutsu 2 on YouTube. And, sir, just give us at the highest level the philosophy of what you was expressing in that clip.
Right. What I was saying about, you know, how you had to terminate and minimize the motivation from your attacker is meaning that if you continue to allow your attacker to galvanize strength by, you know, when somebody's attacking you and they're throwing punches in the, or they're charging you, if you don't stop the momentum, then the person is just revving up. Especially the fact that I was saying that his power, he has generated power, meaning he has already initiated movement. And you know, physics in terms of the body in motion is strong, is greater than the body that is standard. And this is the concept that I was using. So what I was saying is that once the attack has ensued at that point, there's some way you have to cut the force that person is generating. And we know in all our systems, it's intercepting. And we intercept the person's motivation. Although they're already in motion, I'm able to absorb his method. I'm using force, and I'm using strength and force at the same time. But I'm latching on to his force. When he moves forward, I'm riding that force. And then what I'm doing is I cut it, and then I change direction, or what I do is cut it and break it down to that point. So that's where the throws come in. The throws are not coming in from me grabbing him and running him. The throws is coming from his own motivation. He's coming forward. I absorb that force coming forward, and then I neutralize it by controlling it from that point, and then I cut it. So that's what I mean by minimizing the motivation. Because we know this in the street and in boxing, if you backing up and the person's throwing jab, he revs up, he gets stronger. The more throws, the more jabs or punches that he throws, and each time, and the more time he's given, the more power is generated. So I want to minimize that. I want to cut that in half. I want to neutralize that. So that's the concept that we're building on.
Now, Hanshi, you know, in about next week, in a week and a half, we're going to have Professor Tom Curry on the show for some of this rule. And I was talking to him, and, you know, he was an officer, you know, in the detectives at certain points. And he was telling me how, you know, he said, you know, in the dojo, they always say, well, you know, if you throw a guy, if you do a negotiator or whatever type of throw you do, a lot of times, you know, they say, well, once he hits the concrete, you know, that should be the end of him. But he said there's been a few times when he's gotten to situations and he's done a perfect, you know, epon or just a perfect projection or perfect throw. I mean, slam, you know, he would have thought that was the end of it, and the guy got up.
Well, the reason for that is that, see, that's why in ninjutsu, we stay with that person. And the point is that you always want to suppress, because that's what I tell my students. I said, don't depend on the technique working just because you throw the press. That's the fight is not over until you, and when I say completely neutralize that person, I mean you have to have him in some suppressive position where you suppress any motivation. If I throw you, I'm not throwing you just to throw you in midair. If I'm throwing you, there's a certain point where I'm focusing and I'm controlling my concentration on smashing you in the ground rather than throwing you, smashing. Like I was saying, there's some points in ninjutsu where when we throw, I'm trying to create concussion. So I'm throwing you, but at the same time, I'm guiding your head down to the concrete so that some concussion or hopefully some unconsciousness can ensue. And when I throw, I'm still with you. And then maybe I have to break have to create a suppressive technique where I have your arms or your wrists or your fingers and everything as I throw you. That's the point. So the thing is that, you know, you can't depend on the throw alone, because sometimes I studied Aikido, and one of my classmates told me that he has to come to my class because he has to learn just more than just throwing a man away, because he said he was attacked. And sometimes in Aikido, you notice Aikido is momentum and then throw the person away. And that's what he did. But it didn't, like you said, this officer said, he threw the person away, but he didn't finish him off. The throw just got him off him, but the fight wasn't finished. So when he came to my class, I showed him that you don't throw him away, you throw him down. You cut him. If you notice, most of our techniques is when we cut him down rather than throwing him away. And throwing him away is like using judo and sport, judo throws and so forth.
But that's just like with the tired toast, you know. Like, I see a lot of tired toast done on YouTube, and it's like, you know, it's either one or two ways you could do it. But, you know, Dr. Power did the tired toast. He did it in a way where when he did it, he broke your knees.
He broke, there you go. That's what I'm
saying. He broke your knees. So that was the end of it. But listen, Hanshi, man, it was a pleasure to talk to you. I mean, I feel like I've known you forever. I got 2 minutes left, and you know, just I would like you to just take the opportunity to say whatever you want to say, whatever you want to. If you have any seminars coming out, and we'll just wrap the show up.
Well, I really appreciate that, and it's something that you said, that we do have a seminar coming up in February 18th. And the address, it's given by the Shishinkan Bujitsu Humble Dojo on 2756 Reservoir Avenue in the Bronx. So, you know, and the participants is $40, spectators are $20. People can reach me at 347-612-8796. It was an honor, my brother. Just like you said, you know me a long time. You have, because we've been spiritual brothers that long. So I really appreciate you having me. I'm humbled by this experience, and may Allah bless you and everybody else in the audience.
Listen, and in the tradition of you know, my founder and my spiritual master teacher, Dr. Moses Powell, I'm gonna, you know, as my brother and as my elder in heart, I'm gonna end the show by saying eye to eye
and heart to heart.
Listen.